Hello, it's Jang here with a look at a Lego architecture set. This is United Nations headquarters. Comes with 597 pieces officially. Now, at first sight and first impression, this thing looks pretty nice. It's scaled quite small, but still gets the main building standing up pretty tall, so it has a pretty good just general presence to it. But for me, having built this thing, I can definitely say that the most interesting part about owning this entire set was the build. And I really felt like I was learning things as I went through this build, and there were a lot of interesting and unexpected challenges to the design of this whole little layout here that were tackled in interesting ways. A lot of it does ultimately come down to traditional studs not on top construction, mostly studs on side construction, the use of headlight bricks, and you know, various types of brackets and things to offset things, lots and lots of jumpers. And there did end up being some real full-on surprises that caught me off guard. The biggest surprise for me was right here in this main tall secretariat building, as we pronounce it in the United States. Most of this is pretty obvious how it's put together and what pieces are used. And this is pretty much just straightforward studs on top of studs on top of studs, and you've got some brackets off to the sides until you get right up near the top. And this top level of medium blue and light bluish gray, right there, that is upside down. This bracket is upside down, and that last little one by, it's actually a one by two tile piece is actually upside down as well. And that's just interesting how they had to fit that in there in order to get it all to work. So it's just using the tile on the side to hold the thing in place. And it took me a little bit of thinking and trying to figure out why they had to do that, and I realized, oh, okay, now I get it. You see, the top section up here is 9 studs wide, and anytime you go into an odd number of studs of width, you start having to deal with jumpers. So these are actually jumpers right here. These gray pieces are jumpers, just 1x2 jumpers, a couple rows of them. And because of that, they weren't able to line up these white pieces along the top, these plates, with studs right here. They connect it to the jumper right here, but here you could not have a stud, so that's why they actually had to use the underside of this bracket here. It doesn't have any studs on the top of it in order to slide under just this top section right here. So it has nothing to do with what's going on down below, has nothing to do with what's going on from the side. It's all just about this odd width to the top of the building. Another interesting thing is the general assembly building over here, which had a difficult shape to try to replicate in Lego, especially in this scale. So they tried to approximate the inward curved concave sides of the building by going a fraction of a plate, actually a half of a plate at a time. So that involves a whole lot of studs on the side construction in order to get that to actually work, but it's done nicely. I think it's done to good effect, and you know, you can understand what's going on there when you look at it. One thing that I don't like here, and you'll see this in a handful of places throughout the set, is the use of gray on the inside. I wish they could have used white pieces all through, because just some of those gaps are a little bit too obvious. This back here actually is understandable because they've got light blue, trans light blue behind there for windows, but looking at some of these more solid areas, I wish that didn't show up. To me, that just kind of detracts a little bit from the finished look of it. Also, the dome over the General Assembly Hall, I kind of feel like that could have been done in gray, just like these little bits over here. But that's just a subjective decision. Back here, you'll notice more of the use of half plate movement as you go from section to section to just kind of dither out that odd angle that normally you wouldn't be able to pull off. So that's another nice usage there of that technique. You will find, if you build this thing, you will find a lot of tiles used that are kind of balanced in place, that aren't using all of their connection points. So some things actually do need to have a good amount of time applied to just aligning them. For instance, these four tiles right here on the top of this smaller building, those are just 1x2 tiles, and they're on top of a single row of studs, of a 1x4 row of studs in the form of two 1x2 plate pieces. So those you have to line up yourself, and you know, you just want to use something flat there and make sure that it's fairly parallel, and all of them, you know, there's the tiny bit of gap between each pair of pieces, and you want to kind of distribute those gaps evenly. The most difficult thing to align for this whole set is definitely all the flagpoles out in the front. That takes quite a bit of time, and not all of them have the exact same shape. There's a little bit of bend to some of these pieces, so I had to go through and one by one, you know, once you get them all fairly straight up and down as viewed from the front, then you go and look at it from the side and you try to line up all those heads there, and that's a lot more difficult than it appears. And I still didn't get it done perfectly, but a lot of these had to be actually picked up slightly so they're not actually on the base. If you just have them all the way down, the slight differences in bends of the lever sections, the handle sections, will cause them to be all back and forth, and they actually vary quite a bit. So that's something that definitely takes a good deal of patience, just something that you'll need to look out for. I really like how much depth they were able to get into small spaces, like how much depth is under there, under the eaves there. Even the placement of this little connector right there has a little bit of gap around it, but I still like the look there. Also, there are more eaves, well, some overhang here. Interesting little shaping in this area where they tried to make up some space. They actually did it pretty well. And then overhangs here, so these are panel pieces, you know, 1x4 there, 1x2 panel piece, so that gives you a little bit of a shaded area beneath there as well. I think that's nice. It's very nice, you know, for such small spaces to get these really crisp little shapes in different ways. I think it was difficult, I can tell you that. And getting some of the corners especially to work was the toughest thing. A lot of these areas are easy enough to pull off just building in one direction, like building out sideways, but then how do you turn the corner and still have that be flush? That's where a lot of the interesting Lego math comes into play. Ultimately, the end result here, if you just step back and just admire the thing on the whole and don't try to pick it all apart and just see what's been created here, from the eyes of Lego building, I think it's a real success. And as always, architecture sets seem kind of expensive for the volume of stuff that you end up getting, but in this case here, regardless of part count, regardless of actual price, I feel like I got a learning experience here. I feel like I got a real just intellectual experience putting the thing together. It challenged me, it worked my brain. It was interesting. So I actually very much appreciate that kind of intellectual entertainment that I got out of building this thing. That's a lot more valuable to me than the end result, the finished product. So I think this is another really, really, really good example of the Lego architecture whole theme, just really at its best. But that's about all I have to say about this set. If you have anything you'd like to add, feel free to comment. As always, thank you for watching. Hope I showed you everything you wanted to see here. I will be talking to you again very soon.